I didn't think I was very interested in nuclear back when, and after I did get into it, I wondered, well, why? What was different about molten salt? And for me, one of the things that I really like about the molten salt reactor is the fact that it can handle a class of materials, waste and fission products. And that really is a unique and compelling aspect of the molten salt reactor that I get very excited about. So today I'm going to talk quite a bit about fission product handling. I think this is relevant to just about everybody who's doing molten salt work, and certainly very relevant to our work. Hi, I'm Kirk Sorensen with Flibe Energy, and I'm here at the Oak Ridge Molten Salt Reactor Workshop. We've had a great year at Flibe Energy. On July 10th, we were notified that we had been awarded Department of Energy funding opportunity to pursue an innovative technology approach for the fluorination of molten salts. The fluorinator is really the heart of the chemical processing system of any molten salt fluoride reactor. Of course, all fission reactors turn fissile material like uranium or plutonium into an array of fission and activation products, such as plutonium and neptunium. And these fission and activation products have a wide variety of physical and chemical properties. Some are noble gases, some are metals, some are volatile at the temperature of operation, and others remain dissolved in the fuel matrix. At the moment that these fission products are formed, they're furiously radioactive, throwing off beta particles as they rapidly transmute to a stable nuclear form within a month or so of their birth from fission. But regardless of the final form or properties, these fission and activation products will accumulate in the fuel of a nuclear reactor. In conventional solid-fueled reactors, the consumption of fuel, the degradation of cladding material, these are generally the reason that the reactor must shut down for refueling rather than the buildup of fission products. But in a fluid-fueled molten salt reactor, the potential exists to refuel the reactor during operation by adding fissile material to the fuel salt. And the cladding degradation issue doesn't apply because molten salt reactors use fluoride salts as the chemical medium, and this medium is impervious to radiation damage due to its ionically bonded nature. So this leaves the buildup of fission products as the only real threat to the operation of the reactor. Now, a fluid-fueled reactor has attractive options for the long-term management of fission products. They can be chemically isolated and separated from the fuel salt in a manner analogous to the way that the kidney processes and removes waste products from the bloodstream. A variety of different approaches have been proposed for liquid fluoride nuclear reactors, and these include the distillation of the fuel salt itself, leaving the fission and activation products in the heel of the salt. Another proposed method is to selectively precipitate certain neutron-absorbing fission products by overwhelming the salt with another material transparent to neutrons, such as cerium. Reductive extraction is yet another process, and here the fuel salt is contacted with a metallic chemical reductant that will preferentially reduce fission products from fluoride salts to metals. The MSRE considered distillation as a viable option since it appeared simple in concept. The high temperatures required for the distillation of a carrier salt, such as Flibe, from a fuel salt are challenging, however. There's also the inefficiency issue of repeatedly attempting to boil a large inventory of salt away to concentrate a very small inventory of fission products, because inevitably some of the valuable carrier salt will follow the fission products into the waste stream. Precipitation with cerium is also a challenging method for fission product management because it introduces another chemical species into the carrier salt at ever-increasing concentrations, rather than actually removing the fission products and leaving no residual behind. Reductive extraction of fission products increasingly appears to be the most attractive way that has been thus far suggested to manage the long-term buildup of fission products in the fuel salt, particularly if lithium metal is used as the reductant. And because lithium is one of the constituents of the Flibe salt that makes up the solvent into which nuclear fuel is dissolved in the reactor, its addition over time will not be detrimental, and it's much more easily managed than a more foreign species like cerium. Metallic lithium can be alloyed with metallic bismuth to carefully manage lithium's introduction into the fuel salt. And bismuth is immiscible with the fluoride fuel salts that are generally favored for molten salt reactors. there are two different ways we can imagine doing reductive extraction. One is a chemical manner, which bismuth is just contacting the fuel salt, and another is an electrolytic manner, where an electrical potential is applied to more carefully control the addition of lithium reductant and the removal of metallic fission products. Now, ideally, a technique for the removal of fission products from the fuel salt of the reactor would be employed that would operate directly on the fuel salt without any pretreatment. But one of the aspects of the nature of reductive extraction is that it will tend to remove the most noble contents of the salt first, and the actinides tend to be substantially more noble than the fission products. This figure provides an overview of how extractable various species are from the lithium-beryllium system. Zirconium, uranium, plutonium, protactinium, and other actinides tend to reduce from a salt in preference to the lanthanides. Thorium, on the other hand, is a notable exception. Zirconium, uranium, plutonium, and several other minor actinides not depicted in this graph are all more susceptible to being removed from the fuel salt than neodymium and europium, which represent the larger class of lanthanide fission products. Thorium, which might be present in a breeder salt blanket, has an even lower propensity to be removed from a fuel salt than lanthanide fission products. But if one can imagine a fuel salt that doesn't contain any thorium and where uranium is the dominant actinide species, there is a very simple and sophisticated solution to the problem. And this approach is fluorination. This is where you contact the salt with a fluorinating agent in order to chemically alter the uranium tetrafluoride found in the salt to its gaseous state, uranium hexafluoride. And depending on what you use and the temperature in which you use it, you may oxidize or fluorinate other species from a trivalent or tetravalent state. Neptunium and plutonium do form volatile hexafluorides, but plutonium hexafluoride is thermodynamically unstable. So if you're using a salt that predominantly consists of uranium as the fissile species, then you can utilize fluorination to get the valuable actinides out of the salt before undertaking reductive extraction to remove fission products. The appeal of fluorination as a technology for the removal of uranium from fluoride fuel salt was noted for many years, and fluorination formed an integral part of the chemical process flow sheets that were developed at Oak Ridge under the Molten Salt Reactor Program from 1957 to 1976. Fluorinators were envisioned in a variety of locations in the system, universally under the assumption that they were going to remove uranium from the fuel salt. But despite the prevalence of fluorination as an envisioned chemical process, the actual amount of development that was undertaken on continuous fluorination was surprisingly small. Batch fluorination, on the other hand, was utilized to remove uranium from the fuel salt of the Molten Salt Reactor Experiment in 1968. But this was done in the drain tank of the reactor and led to the introduction of a significant amount of corrosion products. Repeated fluorination of the MSRE fuel salt in this manner would have undoubtedly led to the structural failure of the drain tank due to corrosion. At the heart of the challenge of fluorination is the nature of the gaseous species used. F2, molecular fluorine, is very assertive, very hazardous, highly corrosive. It's very good at its job, though, but it effectively converts materials to their fully fluorinated highest oxidation state. And this behavior is simultaneously its greatest advantage and its greatest risk. Even oxide fuel can be fluorinated. In fact, this is how we turn uranium oxides mined from the earth into material prepared for enrichment, by first fluorinating it from uranium oxide to uranium tetrafluoride and then to uranium hexafluoride. But the aggressiveness of molecular fluorine led to many practical engineering challenges in the development of a continuous fluorination system. To protect the fluorinator from attack, Oak Ridge engineers envisioned using an extensive interior cooling system to freeze a layer of salt on the fluorination column's inner surface. A fuel salt containing fresh fission products has a considerable internal heat generation term that can be opposed by an external cooling system to form that frozen wall on the interior surface of a fluorination column. But when a chemically similar simulant salt, such as lithium, beryllium, uranium fluoride, where no fission products are present, and you've replaced them with stable isotopes, they have no such internal heat generation term. So it's necessary to simultaneously heat the salt internally to simulate the heating effect of fission products while cooling the wall of the fluorinator to generate the frozen wall. And this was very, very difficult. This made testing exceptionally difficult here during the MSRP, and this issue really was never satisfactorily resolved during the molten salt reactor project. Well, in the years since the MSRE and the MSRP concluded in 1976, alternative fluorination agents have been advanced for consideration. And most notable among these is nitrogen trifluoride. Nitrogen trifluoride has been considered for rocket propulsion and is extensively used in the electronics industry to clean and etch microelectronic silica chips. It's minimally hazardous and not corrosive at temperatures below 70 C and likely to be much less corrosive than other fluorinating agents. It's not known to react with moisture, it's thermally stable at room temperature, and it has been demonstrated at PNNL to be an effective, thermally tunable fluorination agent for spent nuclear fuel constituents. By controlling the temperature at which the fluorination will take place, NF3 can selectively fluorinate various constituents in the salt, and thus provides a mechanism to affect basic separations of the volatile fluorides. So at higher temperatures, at the temperatures at which we would envision a molten salt reactor running, roughly about 600 C, NF3 is a very effective fluorination agent for UF4, NPF4, and many of the transition metal products that form volatile fluorides. The alkaline earths, the lanthanides, and the remaining actinides, including plutonium, will remain dissolved in the salt. Now, this is a very notable departure from the behavior of molecular fluorine, which really indiscriminately converts everything to its most volatile form, if that form exists. The hazard level, chemical reactivity attributes, and other features potentially make NF3 a very attractive fluorinating agent for managing the composition of the fuel salt in a molten salt reactor where uranium is the dominant or even the exclusive fissile material. If we fluorinate the salt with NF3, we can produce UF6 and we can remove uranium from the salt. Then reductive extraction could be employed to remove non-volatile fission and activation products from the salt. Finally, hydrogen would be used to reduce UF6 back to UF4 and reconstitute the salt for return to the reactor. We're very excited to be taking some of the first steps in many years in conjunction with Pacific Northwest Nuclear Laboratory and under the DOE FOA award. And we look forward to successfully demonstrating the effectiveness of nitrogen trifluoride fluorination in a lithium fluoride, beryllium fluoride salt, where we would use that to remove the uranium.
Why is it that now this has happened? It's like I could imagine something like this happening 40 years ago.
Well, the reason this is happening now is because the Department of Energy issued a very unique funding opportunity announcement in December of 2017. Previously, most funding opportunity announcements around nuclear technology in the United States had said, how will you do this thing that we have described? Whereas this opportunity had to do with the companies proposing what could be done, and then the Department of Energy made competitive selections where they would agree to fund the proposed activity. Now, each company that does this has to provide a cost match, and so that's a very important attribute to ensuring that the companies have skin in the game as far as the value of the work that they're proposing to do. But I think it has been a tremendous development that the Department of Energy has gone ahead with this funding opportunity, and we have been very, very grateful because it has given us an ability in a conjunction with our partner PNNL to advocate for the value of this work and show how it could apply to a program of molten salt reactor technology. And ultimately, I was very happy that they decided to make the award. In conclusion, the fuel burnup that we can achieve in an MSR is really limited by the buildup of fission products. And reductive extraction appears to be a very good way to remove these fission products so long as we remove the actinides first. Fluorination can do this for uranium and neptunium, but it's very aggressive when you use molecular fluorine. If we use fluorination using nitrogen trifluoride, it might be much more practical and successful than the previous approaches we've tried. And so I look forward to being able to come back next year and report on hopefully some initial results from the campaign at PNNL on this new form of fluorination. Thank you very much.